Penguin Random House Audio presents Extra Life, A Short History of Living Longer. This is the author, Stephen Johnson. Introduction. 20,000 Days. The stretch of the Kansas River just north of the town of Junction City has military routes that date back to 1853. When a post was established to protect travelers heading west in the years after the California Gold Rush. Within a few decades, the site became known as Fort Riley, and for a time it hosted the United States Cavalry School. In 1917, as the armed forces began preparing for the American entry into World War I, a small city with a population of 50,000 was erected practically overnight to train Midwestern soldiers headed overseas to fight in the Great War. Camp Funston, as it was called, contained around 3,000 temporary buildings, the predictable barracks and mess halls and commander's offices, but also general stores, theaters, and even a coffee house. The pop-up city had meaningful amenities for the young recruits. One soldier wrote home with an account of hearing a symphony entertaining the troops at Camp Funston. But the temporary nature of the structures meant that most of the quarters were barely insulated. The first winter of the camp's existence was an unusually frigid one, forcing the soldiers already bunked together in tight quarters to cluster even closer around the stoves in the barracks and the mess halls. As winter drew to a close in early March 1918, a 27-year-old private named Albert Gitchell presented himself at the infirmary complaining of muscle pain and fever. Gitchell was a butcher by trade and had been serving as a mess cook at Camp Funston, preparing food for hundreds of his fellow soldiers in training. Doctors diagnosed his illness as influenza and dispatched him to the contagion ward in hopes of preventing the spread of the disease, but the intervention proved to be too late. Within a week, hundreds of other residents of Camp Funston reported influenza symptoms. By April, more than 1,000 soldiers at Camp Funston had been hospitalized. 38 of them died, a surprisingly high number for a disease that usually threatened only the very young and the very old. The crowded infirmaries and the bodies piled up in the morgue at Camp Funston were early clues that something unusual was happening at that Kansas Army base. But what was really happening there would not be visible to scientists until the development of electron microscopy decades later. Inside the lungs of Albert Gitchell, a sphere covered in spikes fastened itself to a cell lining on the surface of the young private's respiratory tract. The sphere burrowed through the cell membrane into the cytoplasm, fused its own limited strand of genetic code with Gitchell's, and began making copies of itself. Within about 10 hours, the cell was teeming with newly replicated spheres, stretching the membrane to a breaking point, until, in one catastrophic instant, the cell exploded, releasing hundreds of thousands of new spheres into the mess cook's respiratory tract. Some of the spheres were coughed or sneezed into the air of the mess hall and the barracks. Others remained in the lungs of Private Gitchell, latching onto other cells with the same brutal machinery of self-replication. The doctors at Camp Funston had no way of knowing it at the time, but those spheres attacking Albert Gitchell's lungs constituted a new strain of the H1N1 virus that would come to terrorize the entire world over the next 2 years in the pandemic commonly referred to as the Spanish flu. Just as the virus itself replicated in the respiratory tracts of the soldiers, the scene at Camp Funston would be replicated at military bases around the globe in the coming months, fueled by the steady flow of soldiers across the United States and onto the European front lines. American troops brought the virus to the military port at Brest on the northwest edge of Brittany in France. The virus then erupted in Paris in late April. Italy soon followed. On May 22nd, the Madrid newspaper El Sol reported that a sickness which has not yet been diagnosed by doctors was ravaging the garrisons of Madrid. By the end of May, the virus was in Bombay, Shanghai, and New Zealand. The strain of H1N1 that encircled the globe in the spring of 1918 spread at an alarming rate compared to most influenzas. It passed readily from person to person and successfully set off chains of cell rupture in the lungs of many of those people. But it wasn't particularly lethal. The flu's ability to race around the world in such a short amount of time, all those self-replicating spheres and all those lungs, was formidable. And yet many of those lungs recovered from the attack. In the technical language, the strain displayed a high morbidity rate combined with a more modest rate of mortality. It made copies of itself with fearsome skill, but it tended to let its hosts survive the encounter. The strain of H1N1 that erupted in the fall of 1918 would not be so generous. To this day, scientists debate why the second wave of the Spanish flu in 1918 proved to be so much more virulent than the virus that first emerged in the spring. Some argue that the two waves were propelled by different variations of H1N1. Others believe that the two different strains encountered each other in Europe and somehow combined into a new, more lethal variant. Others believe that the initial wave was weaker because the virus had only recently jumped from animal hosts to human ones and required a number of months to properly adapt to its new habitat in the respiratory tracts of Homo sapiens. Whatever the underlying cause, the wake of death left behind in the second wave was staggering. In the United States, the new threat first became apparent at Camp Devens, an overcrowded military base on the outskirts of Boston. By the third week of September, 1/5 of the camp's population had contracted influenza, a morbidity rate that exceeded that of the H1N1 outbreak at Camp Funston. But it was the mortality rate that shocked the medical staff at Camp Devens. "It is only a matter of a few hours, then, until death comes," one of the Army physicians wrote. "It is horrible. One can stand it to see 1, 2, or 20 men die, but to see these poor devils dropping like flies, we have been averaging about 100 deaths per day. Pneumonia means, in about all cases, death. We have lost an outrageous number of nurses and doctors, and the little town of Ayr is a sight. It takes special trains to carry away the dead. For several days, there were no coffins, and the bodies piled up something fierce. It beats any sight they ever had in France after a battle. An extra long barracks has been vacated for the use of the morgue, and it would make any man sit up and take notice to walk down the long lines of dead soldiers, all dressed and laid out in double rows." The devastation at Camp Devens would soon be followed by even more catastrophic outbreaks around the world. In the United States, almost 50% of all deaths would be attributable to influenza over the next year. Millions died on the front lines and in military hospitals in Europe. The mortality rate for those infected in parts of India approached 20%, an order of magnitude more lethal than the first wave virus had been. Today, the best estimates suggest that as many as 100 million people died of influenza during the outbreak around the world. John Barry, author of the canonical account of the outbreak, The Great Influenza, puts that number in context. "Given the world's population in 1918 of approximately 1.8 billion, the upper estimate would mean that in 2 years, and with most of the deaths coming in a horrendous 12 weeks in the fall of 1918, in excess of 5% of the people in the world died." Mortality reports revealed another disturbing element of the pandemic. The H1N1 outbreak of 1918 to 1919 was unusually lethal among young adults, normally the most resilient cohort in ordinary flu seasons. In the United States, as Barry notes, the single greatest number of deaths occurred in men and women aged 25 to 29, the second greatest number in those aged 30 to 34, the third greatest in those aged 20 to 24, and more people died in each of those five-year groups than the total deaths among all those over age 60. In part, this unusual pattern was attributable to the virus's spread through the close quarters of military barracks and hospitals. Scientists also believe that a similar virus that emerged in 1900 had left a significant portion of the older population immune to the Spanish flu variant. The unusual demography of the Spanish flu was clearly visible in the life expectancy charts that were ultimately calculated for the period. Everyone under the age of 50 saw a precipitous drop in expected life during the H1N1 outbreak, while the life expectancies of 70-year-olds were unaffected by the pandemic. But overall, the story was bleak beyond imagination. In the United States, average life expectancy plunged an entire decade, practically overnight. India may have experienced the lowest known life expectancy of any human society.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.